To the Photoshop Show. Our special guest tonight is Jeff Foster, and Jeff Foster has found the coolest way to take video, to take panoramas, and just still images, and that is from the sky, right, Jeff?
That's right.
Jeff is going to show us tonight how he shoots video and stills using something called a quadcopter, and that's about all I know about it, so I'm going to stay out of it and let him show us what he does. And he's not the only one doing this. All the cool kids are doing that these days, aren't they, Jeff?
All the cool kids, including me, right?
Very cool, yeah. So, Jeff, before we do that, I just would love you to introduce yourself to everybody. Tell us a bit about yourself, where you can be found online, and what you're doing these days.
Okay. Hi, everybody out there. I'm Jeff Foster. You can find me at pixelpainter.com, P-I-X-E-L, painter.com. That's my my blog site. I do a lot of writing and reviewing of products for Pro Video Coalition, and that's how I got started with this whole quadcopter thing, doing videos for GoPro, doing some reviews from them, and I saw this way of getting a GoPro up into the air, and that was something I've wanted to do for a long time. I was thinking of balloons and kites and all these ways of getting a GoPro to this great sky bird's eye view, and these came along, and they've totally taken off in the last 10 or 11 months. So this is a really big thing that's going to revolutionize point of view photography.
Well, that's really cool. And what, you know, I've done a little bit of looking at it because it's all over the place. All my friends are doing it. All you guys, it's such a boy toy, isn't it?
Well, I know a lot of girls doing it too now. So
I do too. Bonnie the Hot is doing it, and some other
that's
people.
Right.
Yeah, but anyway, so you're going to show us how you do that and talk about what it is, because some people might not even know what you're talking about.
Sure.
But before we do that, I want to say hi to the other guy down there. Hi, Ron.
Hi, how you doing, Jan? Yeah, I'm really excited for tonight. The first time I actually saw live a quadcopter was at Photoshop World in September, and Barry Blanchard and Russell Brown were down there at the Adobe booth, and we had made this plan, this really secret plan, the Kabili group there, to do a surprise flash mob of the Adobe booth. And so we had all these hundreds of people about to do a flash mob, and it was ready to be quadcopter filmed, and it would rise up as this flash mob began to slowly, you know, explode from the crowd. And just before the flash mob came on, security came up. This was like the near the end of the whole conference, and said, after they had been flying these all week long, came up and said, sorry, we're going to have to shut it down. It's not safe to fly them in the building anymore. And so we didn't get a video of the flash mob.
The bummer.
But they have got to be one of the coolest toys on the planet, at least this year anyway.
Well, that's interesting that they said that. That's an issue, right, Jeff, this who gets the airspace thing?
Yeah, there's a lot of things about that. And there are actually some FAA regulations. And it's actually a very short list, but they're very limited, and I'll go over that, too, a little later.
Excellent, excellent. All right, so we're going to let Jeff kind of sit back there and breathe a little. and as I always do, I'm just going to show you a quick tip in Lightroom. Actually, I think I'll show you two tips today because they're so short. So let me screen share and then switch over to Lightroom. Seems like every time I screen share, everything has changed. Can you see Lightroom now on my screen?
Yeah.
Cool. Well, on my screen you may see a wonderful picture of a really cute dog. Is that what you see?
Yeah.
So that dog is, before I show you my tip, since this is half my show, I guess I get to say anything I want. And so I wanted to say a kind of rest in peace to this wonderful dog.
Oh.
Yeah, he's my dog. I've had him for 13 years, and his name is Jebediah Obadiah Zachariah Simpson, otherwise known as Jeb. And Jeb met his the rabbits in the sky today. He had to go. So I love him, and I miss him, and I just want to say thank you, Jeb, for being such a great dog, way more than just a dog. You know, he went everywhere with me. He went out. Jeff, you know, when I moved out to California to work at lynda.com, he went with me there. Then he came back to Boulder when we moved back to Boulder. He helped me raise three kids, and he had his own friends too, not just our family and my friends. He would go off for walks by himself whenever he could get out, and everyone loved him down on Pearl Street in Boulder. He would visit his favorite shops, and you know, he was a great dog. So I miss him, and I'm sorry.
Yeah, sorry to hear that.
Yeah. So that's Jeb. He didn't look like that by the time he left today. He was kind of getting sick. So anyway. So that's the sad thing, but I really am a firm believer in just continuing on and not just wallowing in sadness. So I'm sad, but the show has to go on, so I'm going to just go on. So what I wanted to show you today was something pretty simple, but that I think you might like, and that is what to do when there are a couple of tips for importing photos into Lightroom. So, you know, one way to import is you can always click the big import button or go up to the file menu and choose import photos and video. But I found another way to do it that I really like, because I don't like to go navigating to things. I can't remember what they're called and all of that. So I'd rather just click on something and drag it in. So to import a folder of photos to Lightroom, another way to do it, I'm just going to make Lightroom a little smaller so that I can see behind it. And let me close this. I've got my desktop here, and on my desktop I have a folder of photos. So I'm just going to drag that folder of photos onto my screen, and that opens the import dialog box to just the photos in that folder. Did you know that?
That's cool.
Isn't that cool? It's way better for me, because I don't have to then go looking around through my, you know, my operating system for the folder I want to bring in. And that folder doesn't have to be on your desktop, of course. It can be anywhere in your computer, as long as you know where it is and can drag it in. And these beautiful headshots of my daughter, Kate Kabili, who is a hip-hop dancer in Los Angeles, I could just click import and they would all come in now. So that was tip number one. Tip number two is, when you are importing photos, you have a bunch of panels over on the right in the Lightroom import window, and you may notice that I don't have any panel here right now where I could add keywords or add develop settings or even add metadata like a copyright as I import my photos. And those are all things that I like to do from time to time. And I've noticed on the Lightroom forums people saying, oh my gosh, I'm in the import dialog box and I'm missing some panels. What the heck is going on? Well, that probably just means that somewhere along the way you inadvertently closed a panel or two. So I wanted to show you what to do if you end up with the situation like I'm in now, where I don't have all my panels available here in my import dialog box. All you have to do is right-click or control-click on a Mac on whichever panel is there, and then you'll see a list of all the available panels. Well, because I'm now importing from my computer, there are only two panels I could have, file handling and apply during import. So I'll check apply during import, and that brings the panel back. And then I could expand it and work in that panel. And when you're importing from a camera's memory card, of course you have more panels that you get over in this column on the right, like a destination panel is another one you would get. But so when you're, if you're flummoxed about where the panels are, you just right-click or control-click on any panel you see and toggle back on the missing panels, as I just did. Yeah, so that's what I wanted to show you. Pretty quick, pretty simple, but some things that might help you when you're importing.
That's great advice. Yeah, I had a situation pop up recently where, you know, you're tired, and I was showing someone about Lightroom, and the panels weren't on the right, and I didn't have that situation. They weren't there at all. And I had forgot to click the correct instruction on the upper, whether it's copy, move, add, create DNG. And so I had it just copying, I think. And so there was no panel at all to put metadata in.
Well, that's huge. Actually, let me go back to Lightroom. I was futzing around because I wanted to show you something else. But here in Lightroom, this is the most important part of the import dialog box. You're talking about this area at the top where you choose either to add your photos, which means add them in place, wherever you put them on whatever drive you keep your photos on. That's the best choice when you're importing photos that are not from your camera, that are already in your operating system somewhere. What you must have done, Ron, in your situation is by mistake click copy.
Yeah, you don't copy.
PNG. That's right. Yeah. Yeah. And you're not the only one. People do this all the time. And like, they will pay me to come to their house and try to figure them out, you know, figure out what the heck they did wrong. And you really don't have to get me over there. All you have to do is remember that the best choice here is add when you're trying to bring in photos that are already on your drives, not copy or copy as DNG.
That's right. Okay. Yeah, I just wanted to point that out because it was completely blank. And I've imported probably millions of pictures. And I just completely bypassed it, and it had me confused for a few minutes.
Yeah, it's a drag. I wish this said add in place, and then you might, you know, be able to intuitively figure it out. Well, anyway, when you are importing, there's a lot to know. And so I was going to send you to another resource, and it's kind of a blatant plug, but I also think it's a great resource. And it's something on lynda.com. You know, if you are not a member of lynda.com, of course, you can't see all of the great content there. But what you can do is go to the blog. And many people don't even know there is a blog at lynda.com. But if you type in blog.lynda.com in your address thing, in your URL thing in your browser, then you'll find all kinds of great content there for everybody to read. You don't have to be a member. You don't have to be logged in. So I just wrote a post recently about 5 tips for importing your photos into Adobe Lightroom, and it talks about the couple of tips I told you now and some others as well. So I would urge you to go and check that out. And there's lots of other stuff here, like here's something about DSLR video tips and lots more. So I am now done, so I'm going to stop sharing my screen, if I can figure that out. Oh, I know why. I'm in the wrong browser. Oh, there we go. Can you see me again?
Yep.
Cool. Yep.
See you just fine.
So, and by the way, Jeff, we didn't cover this, but the way that you get out of screen sharing is you click screen sharing again.
Right, right. I did notice that when we were trying it out earlier.
Cool. So that's about it for me, but I'm very happy to turn the floor over to our special guest, Jeff Foster. Jeff, I'm so happy to see you again. I used to sit right next to Jeff in a cubicle. And
a cube farm.
That's right. He's a good friend, and I'm really excited to have him here. Now, Jeff, you didn't tell everybody everything about you, so if I could just brag about you a little bit.
Oh, okay.
You're an author. You've written a bunch of books, right?
Yes.
And
The last one I wrote was The Green Screen Handbook, and I just am signing on with a new publisher to do a second edition. So that's going to be coming out on Focal Press sometime next summer. And so we're going to be updating it with a whole bunch of new material and bringing it current. So I'm excited about that. That'll be great to be working with Focal Press. So.
And you're also an expert in After Effects, right?
I've been doing After Effects since before Aldis bought them from COSA and before Adobe bought Aldis. So, yeah, it's been a while.
Oh, dear, but you look so young. How did that
happen? Well, I could tell you all about my printing days in the 70s and 80s. And so, yeah.
When you were just a teenager.
yeah, just a kid. Oh, boy.
That's great. And you know a lot of stuff that I want to learn.
Yeah, let's hopefully we can share some of it here and there. So, yeah.
Why don't you go ahead and share what you were going to show us about
Okay. Quadcopters
and what do you call that in general, the topic?
Well, people mistakenly call them drones. Well, these things don't spy on people. They don't kill people. we call them quadcopters because they really are quadcopters. I've got one right here. And let me see how much of it's actually showing in the screen here, because these are square screens. Let me see. Yeah, you can see that, right?
Yeah, it's good.
Okay. So let me move my mic out of the way a little bit here. All right. So this is a quadcopter, and the reason why it's called a quadcopter, it's basically a helicopter that has 4 blades on it. And that's to keep it stable in the air. The guts in it, the electronics in it, tell it to correct if it's, the wind's blowing or whatever. It's got GPS in it so that it will hover in one place and maintain a specific altitude and location. And you can turn the GPS on and off and everything. There's a lot of controls with these things. This one here is, the original was manufactured by DJI, and they're one of the largest manufacturers of aerial craft, hexcopters and on up. And they came out with this about, I think it was like last December, they came out with the basic unit. And this one, however, has been beefed up by some guys out of Florida, DSLRpros.com. They have enhanced the electronics, the transmitters, they've added extra things like first-person viewing, FPV they call it, which allows you to transmit what the camera sees. This is a little GoPro on there. This is also on a gimbal. And that's something I'm going to show you some examples with the movies here in a little bit. So the gimbal, when it's powered on, the gimbal holds the camera steady. So if the copter is moving like this in the wind, it holds the camera steady. So you get a nice smooth shot. And that's really an important feature. Then on this one, again, since it's all beefed up, it's got, you know, better props and everything on it, the controller is more sophisticated too. It's more like this. It's a aftermarket controller. And they've got this all already set up for this particular craft. So when you're flying it, you get some data that shows up here on the screen. This is the other half of that that first-person viewer that I showed you the antenna for. This is the other half of that. What happens is this will show you what the camera sees in near real time. So if you lose sight of your craft, it's behind some trees or over the hill, you'll be able to see what the camera sees, and it'll help you line up and get it to fly back or fly over what it is you're looking for. So this really helps you line up the shot. And so this unit here, because it's so advanced, has all of this extra stuff on it, that's going to run you about $4,000.
Whoa.
So it's not something that you want to fly out over the freeway and drop it and let a truck run over it. So,
but people have done that, right? Didn't Colin Smith fly his into the ocean or something?
He hit the pier down in Newport Beach, I believe it was. And he just got too close to the pier, hit the pier, and it dropped right into the water, and he lost it forever because it sinks just like a brick.
Uh-huh.
So, and then another one I'm going to show you. This one is brand new. They just started shipping this month. This one is the Phantom 2 Vision, and this one has its own built-in camera. And Russell and Barry Blanchard and I, we've all been flying these for a few weeks and been playing with them and getting some samples. I'm going to show you some examples from this as well. And Russell and his buddies at Adobe are coming up with some lens profiles for Photoshop for this.
Wow.
And they already have some for GoPro.
Maybe people may not know who Russell is. Who's Russell?
Russell Brown. How could you not know who Doc Brown is?
We know who he is, but not everybody.
Well, oh, all I have to do is Google him. Yeah. What more can I say? I can't explain who he is.
He's Russell Brown.
He's Russell Brown. He is Photoshop. So,
you know, you know what? He's a director of Adobe. Did you know that?
He's like senior creative director, whatever.
Yeah.
He's the crazy guy that dresses up and does crazy stuff. So, anyway, this one comes with its controller like so. And actually, this one has a bigger battery in it. The other one here that I showed you, this one, I feel like a kid with my toys.
Yeah.
But this one, the battery only lasts you about 8 or 9 minutes, maybe 10 at the max. And then you have to bring it back and put a new battery in, or it'll just die. This one, the new one, has a battery that will last you about 20 to 25 minutes. And it's a proprietary battery. The thing with this is, let me turn this and this on. I'll turn this on, and you'll see it do its thing.
How much is this one?
This one comes complete with the camera and with everything. Let me turn it on. Here we go.
Oh, wow.
So it's got little flashing lights, and it's going to be probably hollering at me because it doesn't have GPS, and I've got it in GPS mode now. I'm inside, so it's not going to read GPS. But it... yeah, it gives you an indication of your battery life. It tells you which is front, which is back. When this is functioning and ready to fly, these will light up green.
Wow.
And red. So let me set that down for a second. And the cool thing with this is, with this transmitter, I can use my iPhone and go in here and let me turn it on. And they've got an iPhone app that works with your Wi-Fi, so I'm going to be just grabbing my Wi-Fi. This is probably not showing up well on there. But I'm going to choose this particular unit. And what it does is this talks to this. And then this has an extender that talks to the camera on the Phantom. So I'm going to go ahead and launch my app. There we go. And then this will clip right here. So you're seeing a reflection for the most part. But what it will show, there I can see the little light there.
We're
so you can see the camera that's on here, and you can see my messy desk. So that's how you can see what's going on with the craft itself. So let me set it down here in front of the keyboard.
Okay, wait a minute. I want to get this straight. This one is called the what, and it costs how much?
This one's $1,200, $1,199, and it comes with everything except your smartphone.
Oh.
So this is a great entry-level thing for people that want to get into it without having to buy the GoPro and all the other stuff. This is definitely the way to go. And especially if you're a photographer and not so much into video, this is the way to go too, because it has a 14-megapixel camera. It's got really nice quality. And you don't have to worry about, there's no gimbal on this. So it's not going to handle video as well. But it does allow you to, from the iPhone, control the camera. Let me show it here. See, it'll control it going up and down. Come on, go down. There we go. See it go down?
Yep.
And that's just the touch screen on the iPhone itself. And then I could take a picture or I could take video. And it's just all the controls for the camera are on here. The nice thing with this is also... it gives me feedback as far as the altitude. Right now it's telling me it's at 3.8 feet because it's on my desk. So
wow.
We live at sea level. So, but it will tell you your altitude. It will tell you your speed, your distance, and all of that. So this one doesn't have nearly the distance of the others. So it is more of an entry-level device for that, but it's really easy to fly compared to the others, too.
Okay, so
I have a burning question because
yes.
I saw one of these crazy videos on, I saw one of these crazy videos on YouTube. Showed obviously I don't know who's flying it. Somebody obviously that didn't have control over the copter flying.
A lot of those
was flying at a wedding and flew this copter.
Oh, yeah.
Now the question is, there's no protection around those little.
They do make some little guards, but they don't fit this particular one because these blades are a little bigger than the old one. I think probably within the next few months you'll start seeing some, but they do make some guards that attach to these.
Because
you'll see them in one of my videos. You'll see it as well.
I was going to say, I imagine those things, they spin up pretty good. It could do a bit
Well, they do, and actually what hit the guy wasn't the propeller necessarily is what cut his forehead. Was the impact of the craft itself.
It was moving.
Yeah, because really, when these blades are spinning, they got such low torque that, and it's just little electric motors. So, you could probably cut paper with it, It'd probably beat a leaf or some paper to death. But if you jammed your hand in there, it won't even break the skin.
Oh,
so
okay.
The torque is so low on them, it's really not a big deal. The worst part is thinking, okay, this thing, something happens and it comes falling out of the sky at a few hundred feet and lands on something.
Yeah.
It still weighs a couple pounds, a few pounds or so. So it's going to, it's going to break obviously, but if it hits somebody on the head from a couple hundred feet up from a dead drop, that's going to be a problem. So, anything that's got mass, that's going to be flying around, you have to be careful. And that's what I was going to say. The FAA rules are you can't go over 400 feet from the surface. That means if you start at 2,000 feet, you're up in the mountains more, you can't go higher than 2,400 feet. So that's why it's good to have something that's going to give you feedback and let you know what your altitude is. This new one, the Vision, will do that. Some of the more sophisticated ones give you that feedback as well. And the DSLR Pros guys are, and I'm not just giving them a plug because they're doing this, but they are really always updating and upgrading their stuff. So That, the other rule from FAA, obviously it's common sense. That's why it's a short list. Use common sense.
Not so common.
And some of the common sense is, you know, don't fly it into somebody's head at a photo shoot. Yeah. You know, or don't fly it into skyscrapers in Manhattan or wherever you happen to be. And there's plenty of videos out there. You just have to look at, quadcopter crashes on YouTube, and you'll see a ton of them. Because, you know, per capita, there are so many of them out there, and there will continue to be more of these because they're getting cheaper and there's more visibility on them. But there's also, you've got a lot of stupid people.
Yeah.
You know? What do you do there? So, it's no different than anything else. You've just got to trust that people will make the right choices. You can't fly within a couple miles of a landing strip. I think it's 3 miles from a landing strip in a flight path of an airport, and then the 400-foot thing, and just not over any populated areas or restricted airspace. Like, you can't fly one of these over the walls of a prison or, you know, or at an Air Force base or anything like that. So, that won't work. And in some states, they actually have written laws that it's okay to shoot them out of the air. So, stay away from the hillbilly states that they're shooting everything that's flying, you know? So,
Wait, I have a question. So what about a cheaper way to get into this? Like, if you didn't even want to spend $1,200, can you rig your own thing up with some old GoPro you have and something?
You can still buy the basic Phantom from DJI's, one of their distributors. I have DSLR Pros even sells those, too, the basic one for about, I think it's like $700 or $800. And then you can strap whatever GoPro you want on it. It won't have a gimbal, you know. It won't be as fancy as this, but it will get you going. So that you can get. There are other brands out there. They make cheaper ones that you can slap a GoPro on. It's, again, just Google search and
quadcopters. I want to make sure that we kind of move on to there's a couple of things that are really important. One that I'm really curious about, because we've lightly covered it. We've had guests on before talking about kind of mixing. You're up there, you're taking some video, you're taking some pictures, you're flying it around, you have a great afternoon, you get home, you got the footage. Where do you go from there? What's the next step?
Well, hopefully you've got footage. Sometimes you think you hit the record button before you sent this thing. And that's happened to me several times. So my setup procedure now is to power up the GoPro and set it to record before I even put the battery in to this. So that way I know that I've got it's running and everything's working great. Plus, I'm not touching the camera after this powers up, because this gimbal's very touchy on here. You start messing with it might set it off balance, so you want to kind of leave that alone. But getting it off from the card, it just comes out with a little micro SD card that you use the little adapters for to put in your machine or put in your readers. I've got several different kinds of readers, but it's the micro SD cards that they use. Both the GoPros and the Phantom Vision use those micro SD cards. And that's just, you know, just drag and drop it, or if you're using something like Bulletproof from Red Giant, use something like that. You can ingest it and kind of rough cut it from there, or Prelude. You can rough cut and ingest at the same time. I usually just drag and drop to a folder and then manage with it then, because I like to make exact duplicates of my original footage. So I have some. I'm going to screen share here for a minute, so I can show you some things.
That'd be great.
And then let me see here what I've got. I've got this is a pano that I shot. Can you see that? Okay.
Yep. Oh, looks good. Looks
great. Okay. Great. This pano. This is a day that I went out shooting with Russell Brown. And this is Baker Beach. It's just to the southwest of the Golden Gate Bridge. You can see over there on the right. And I had a horrible crash with my Phantom, because for some reason there was some radio interference there. It was fine when it first took off, but then it went, and this is like right just a few feet away from the cliffs. And I thought it was going to hit the cliffs, and I was able to get it back toward me, and I thought it was going to go right into the bay, and instead it went upside down into the sand. It didn't hit anybody, thankfully, but that was one of those scary times that I thought for sure I'd lost it. But this is actually about 6 frames of video that was shaky and all over the place. It was crazy. That happens. But a lot of my panos that I get actually end up being taken from video. I don't do a lot of photo shooting with it like Russell does. Russell gets up there and he spins it around and he'll take several snapshots at really high definition and get some beautiful panos. And I typically, because I'm more of a video guy these days, so I like to shoot as much video as I can. And if I'm shooting it like with the GoPro Hero 3 and now the 3 Plus, you can shoot at 2.7K. That gives you a pretty decent file that you can edit video with, as well as get some decent stills from. This one here is a full 360 panorama up on the Columbia River. Taken from that. I've got another one here. This is just outside. This is out in front of our house, basically. Yeah, we live over here in the neighborhood. I do a lot of test flying out here over the water and around the area. This is taken from video, and I think I screwed it up when I was stitching it because I got some real blurry stuff going on here. That's horrible.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Can you just stitch it using merge to what is it? Merge.
Yeah, I use Photo Merge.
Yeah.
But there were some distortion issues, and actually I learned a few tricks from Russell to make that better. So that was an older one. This is one I just shot the other day. This is out where our horse is boarded, and this is again another. This one's like about five frames of video that I was able to stitch together. And Photo Merge does a great job, of course. We all know that. Here's another one that's. Again, about 5 or 6 frames right out here at the bay. And I think I've got one more. So just to show you, making panoramas from video clips, you can stitch some really nice panos. I think this one's about 4 frames of video. But it makes these nice, beautiful, you know, panos.
Video. Can you show us how to capture the stills from the video?
I can do that, yes, actually. That was going to be one of the things I was going to show you today.
You don't have to do it right now, whenever.
Yeah, that's okay. Got a couple other images here. Just so you can see these better, since you couldn't probably see them well on my camera. On the left is the DSLR Pro's rig with the GoPro. And there, you got the wires sticking out there. I don't have the battery in right now, so the battery's unplugged. But there's the guards that you were asking about, Ron.
Yeah,
I had those installed on that at the time, so you can bump into things, and that protects both the craft and whatever is potentially going to be hit. So you can bump into things or hit trees and stuff, and it'll kind of bounce off, and it'll help, protect things a bit, but it does add a little more weight, and it makes response time a little more slow and cumbersome. So it's a little bit like driving a Cadillac instead of a sports car. So
add a little bit of resistance there.
Yeah. And then of course the other one, the vision is on the right there, and it's a little more streamlined. So that's those guys. And this is a shot here. This is on the same day that I went out shooting with Russell Brown. Now, his copter is down here at the bottom center of the screen. I'm not sure if you can see that.
Yeah.
Little white X there. Well, that's his Phantom. And we were flying around the Dutch windmill here in Golden Gate Park. And that was a lot of fun. Speaking of Russell Brown, there he is. So we can kind of pretend he joined us tonight, right?
Yeah. Hi, Russell. Glad you can be here.
There he is. This is another frame from a video I shot, and I'll actually show you the video here in a minute. I took this about a week and a half ago down at Santa Cruz, and I was flying above the surfers and happened to just get in the stream of where these flying V formation of pelicans was coming right at the craft.
Yikes.
And they just split off around it. They just ignored it and just split around it. So that was actually pretty cool. And I didn't know I got that till I got home, and I knew I was close to them, but I didn't know that I had captured quite that shot until I got home. So, and flying around sailboats or San Francisco out there in the background, this is a place I frequently like to go. One of our local flyers here contacted me through Facebook and says, "Hey, come join me. I got this really cool spot down in the marina." So I want to give a shout out to Michael Little for helping me find this great location and show me some cool places to shoot. So let me show you, before I get into anything with software, let me show you, I'm going to open up the YouTube channel here and see if this will let me play any of these videos. So we'll start with this one. It's not playing for you? Yeah, sometimes I like seeing the shadow and sometimes I don't. This is kind of cool there. I can hear you.
That was so great. That was terrific. Thank you so much.
Yeah, that was the first one that I showed you with the GoPro and the gimbal and that whole setup. This one shows you kind of in a nutshell how the vision works, and I've got some screenshots in there too. So does this work if I hit play, or do you have to do it, Ron? Okay, can you hear me talking now?
Yes.
Okay, good. Yeah, that was that just kind of gave you an idea of how it looks when you're looking at your iPhone. You can preview what the camera sees and all of that. Again, it's a lot shakier video than what you get out of the one with the gimbal, the GoPro, because it's fixed mounted to the craft. So any movement of the craft, you see it in the video, but it's still cool. I think it's great to get that point of view and be able to fly it so easily. It's so much easier to fly than some of the more sophisticated ones.
Well, that's really neat. You know, unfortunately, we don't have a ton of time left.
Yeah.
Do some processing. Could you?
Okay, sure. One of the things, and I'd like to end on this next video when we come back, if we can, because that shows you what some of the results of the processing. Okay. So I'll turn that off right now.
And, yeah, we'll just outro with it. That's all.
I'm sorry?
You say we'll outro with it.
That's right. That'd be the good outro, is to go with that. Yeah. So let me see. Am I still screen sharing?
Yes, you are.
Okay, good. Let me share with you a couple things in Photoshop. Let me come down here to Photoshop. And let me bring up a couple things here. This one, I've got a shot that should open up. There we go. Okay, so this is straight from one video clip. And a lot of times when I'm doing my video clips, I want to grab something from a video clip. There's a lot of ways to do it. You can grab it out of Premiere or After Effects, or even in Photoshop, you can kind of scrub through video and grab a specific frame and pull it out. Photoshop isn't a great video editor. We all have probably played with it, but it's really not meant to do that. You can, and there are ways to get through it. Colin Smith shows a lot of stuff in a lot of videos, and he does a lot of on-the-road training of video editing in it. But it's really kind of a kludgy workflow as far as I'm concerned. It's tough. It can be done, but we can't get into that today because it really is an intensive process. But what I will show you is some of the corrections that you can make to the frames that you grab. Typically, what I'll do is grab a frame out of QuickTime Pro. I run QuickTime Player Pro, QuickTime 7. It's not even the newest one. But I'll just grab a single frame out of that and copy, paste it into a new Photoshop doc, and that's how I typically grab my my frames out. But this is one frame of video, and say I don't want this barrel distortion here, the wide angle distortion on the horizon. Sometimes I do. I like that effect because it shows that it is a super wide angle frame. But a lot of people don't want that. So I've got a couple lens profiles here that Russell and his team at Adobe have been building. And I can come up here to my lens correction. And if this was shot with the GoPro, I can come over here to my search criteria, the camera make, and I can select my GoPro lens profile. And we'll see that this is probably a bit over distorted. So I know that I shot this with my DJI instead. So I'm going to grab these and deselect them. Oh, it won't let me deselect them. Let me see if it'll just do that. Oh, it does. I thought it stacked them. Okay, so this is an experimental one. They haven't quite finished it yet. So I found a way of tweaking this a bit and getting exactly the shot I want right here in my custom settings here. So I click on custom, and I can remove just a little bit of that distortion just to bring the outsides down just a bit. I can rotate my angle a bit. Oh, hello, too much.
You know, I really hate that interface of the angle. What is it?
Yeah, it's a little touchy, isn't it?
Yeah, crazy.
It's a little touchy. So that, and you can, if you've got any kind of vignetting or anything else that's going on in there, you can adjust that, or you can actually add vignetting if you want to give it an effect. You can add a little bit of vignetting. Typically, I leave that alone unless I have to correct something. So But just those two settings on there give me this really nice flat horizon out here. I click OK. Then I can see, just going back and forth, that was before and this is after. It gives you really an entirely different perspective on the shot. Now, you can also do this exact same thing to video footage. If you bring it in and convert it to a smart object, then you can use this same lens correction on the video footage as a smart filter on a smart object.
Oh, that's great. So will it affect an entire clip or more than one clip?
It takes forever to render it out, but it will do that. And the same thing with the camera raw filter. You can apply that to a video clip as well. Again, it takes forever to process, but it does in anything, really. But one thing I did find when I applied the camera raw filter, and I got a really nice adjustment on a clip, that because it processes it frame by frame, sometimes the frames will jump and hop, and you get some weird color shifting going on. So I really wish we had that filter in After Effects or Premiere that would normalize it throughout a whole clip. I'm really hoping that someday we'll get that, because it's really a powerful way of getting really nice color grading on your video clips too. So, but that's one really important thing for both GoPro and the Phantom, is to be able to do this lens distortion, especially on your images. Now, I'm going to share with you a portal that Russell Brown has on Adobe TV. It's his channel that he's put together, Take Flight into the Adobe Creative Cloud. And this is a really cool site that he goes through talking about the Hero 3 cameras with the lens profiles, like I just showed you with this lens profile, color correcting, making panoramas. This is really invaluable information. It's all free. It's right on Adobe TV. And the reason why I'm giving you a plug is because it would take me, you know, a couple hours of trying to go through all of this and showing you here. So if your listeners and readers are watching this, just go to Adobe TV and check out this channel. All of these videos are right there, and he shows you in step by step, in depth, how to make all of these corrections. And it's really a powerful set of tools there.
Free. Yeah. Now, Jeff, I wonder if I might interrupt. I was just on the lens correction panel. I just tested something that I thought would work. Just want to see if I can bring it all back up again. I'll even just say it instead of showing you.
Okay.
You know that little dial drives me crazy too. That little
right
angled dial.
Yeah.
You get it even roughly close and grab. You know how to the left of the number, like 0 degrees or 10 degrees, it grabs it like a scrubby slider.
Right.
If you hold the Alt key, it works in very small increments. You
can right. Okay. Well, that would make sense, definitely.
And so that works in many places, but I just checked it, and it works there as well. So if you're having trouble getting that angle just right, you can slow it down to fractions of a degree using the Alt key and the scrubby slider.
Oh, good for you, Ron. That's pretty cool. Yeah.
Excellent.
Just thought I'd put that in there. Yeah.
Sweet.
Very helpful, yes.
It's so interesting about Photoshop. After you know a certain amount, it's kind of like playing the piano. You know a certain amount, you can almost play any new song, right?
Right. That's very helpful. Thanks, Ron. That's a great tip. Very nice. Yes, I like how that works. Much better. Yay. That's great. Cool. All right.
My tip.
I, again, showing Russell's channel. Hopefully you can put that up, or I don't know if you're going to have a links available after the show or not. But
well, yeah, we can put links. I can also put them live in the chat here, too.
Yeah, great. Excellent. But that's a huge resource right there for doing these things. And if Russell was here, he would have shown you that, too. So one thing that I do a lot of is I stabilize my footage, especially shooting with this new Phantom Vision, because it is a bit shaky, and I stabilize my footage in After Effects or Premiere. Both of them have the warp stabilizer. I know we don't have time to get into that today, but what I will show is kind of a before and after. I'm just going to scrub through a couple things. So let me just hide Photoshop here and open this up in my QuickTime player, and I can scrub through this and show you what I'm talking about. Now, this was some footage. I saw some deer on the hill the other day, and I wanted to fly up there and see if I could capture them. Well, you can see this footage is really shaky. I'm just scrubbing through really slowly because I know it's playing back very slow for you guys.
No, that worked. That's cool.
But you can see that it's kind of jumping around a bit. It's not smooth. It's not, you know, you can see the little deer right here.
Yeah.
But the rest of the shot, everything's really shaky. The camera's really shaky as I go through there. And I tried stabilizing this shot, but it was just too shaky. You see, there's a little shadow right here is the shadow of the Phantom. It's fun to watch that. So that's shaking around. Now, I've got a second half here where I stabilized the shot right here. I stabilized it with the warp stabilizer. And if you watch, the deer area stays pretty stable, but everything else out here around the outside starts warping and looking really funky. See, it starts jumping around. Might be a little hard to see from here, but it almost looks like there's heat waves or something going on. It starts warbling around really bad because it can't quite figure out how to correct for that. Mm. But the main part of the footage, the central part of the footage, still looks pretty decent. Now, what I've done before is if I've got a clip that I've shot in, say, 2.7K, which is about 2,700 pixels wide, and I want to edit that in something that's 720p, which is 1280 by 720, I can stabilize my 2.7K footage, bring it into Premiere, and then edit it and crop it so that I'm only looking at the sweet spot, just the center spot that I want to concentrate on. And that crops out a lot of that warbling, warping that goes on out there. And I've done that before, and that really helps. So go ahead.
That's a good tip.
Yeah, well, that's the thing, is that sometimes you have to see what the trade-off is, and is it worth it, and sometimes it's better just to leave it alone. But I know we're running out of time, so I want to close with that last YouTube video that we have queued up there and show you all of these shots that were done on that YouTube were shot with the Phantom Vision, and a lot of them were stabilized using the warp stabilizer in After Effects, and then color corrected just slightly with a three-way color corrector. But this was all shot with the Phantom, you know, no GoPro on this one. So you can see that you can get, with some smooth flying and a little bit of stabilizing, you can get some decent results, even with the lower-end quadcopter. So now, is this something I can hit play, or do you need to do it, Ron?
I'll probably need to do it. Jen, I wonder if we might just let everyone know, say goodbye now and let this play out to the end, or we'll just say it at the end or do it both.
That sounds great. So let's do that. I want to thank Jeff Foster for coming and showing us all this great stuff. Of course, there's a lot more to learn. And I'm telling you, Jeff, this sounds like it needs not only Russell's wonderful voice, but maybe there's room for other voices here, too. A book, maybe a video series.
Oh, there's a lot of plans coming up. We're talking with Creative Live about doing some stuff as well. So, yeah, there's a lot of things coming up.
Well, yeah, Creative Live would do good with this because, live. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, you've been a great guest, and we really appreciate it. I'm sorry, Ron.
I wanted to thank him because this is just, from the time you're a little kid, you just dream of having a toy like this.
I mean, I know.
Really, seriously, the biggest toy in the world. But, yeah.
Well, like I said, I always wanted something that would give me points of view, camera point of views from different areas, not just, you know, aerial flights, but being able to do some of those low shots, and you'll see that in this next video too. I was only about 3 or 4 feet above the waves with the surfers, and I mean, those are shots you just can't get unless you're actually in the water or with a device like this. So you're able to capture things there's no way you could do any other way.
Yeah. And okay,
Jeff, is it true that it's not only photographers and kind of personal videographers who are doing this, but also they use this in Hollywood, don't they?
Well, they do. They use something a little more sophisticated. And if you go to DSLRpros.com, they have some of the more advanced copters that show you. They can lift a red cam or you know, a DSLR. So, you know, they can put more sophisticated cameras on bigger, heavier lift things. But you're looking at, you know, a lot of money, too. You're going to be investing with the cameras and lenses and all the electronics. You can spend $20,000-$30,000 without blinking. So that's what the Hollywood folks are using. That's, you know, they're using the real sophisticated stuff. But for the hobbyist or the amateur photographer, because you can't, and that's one other FAA rule, you can't use these in a commercial space at all for a commercial purpose. So you can't go around, you know, shooting commercials with these copters, big or small, because there's no licensing for it yet. They haven't quite figured out how they're going to approach that. So it's not legal yet to do this commercially. It's only for hobbyists and amateur photographers. So good to point out.
Good for us. So go ahead and show us your outro, okay. And we'll leave with that. But if you ever want to come back and show us more, I know folks would love it.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's great. And this is such a fast-evolving industry that, you know, 3 or 6 months from now, it's going to be entirely different and more sophisticated. It's growing so fast. It's just insane. So okay. I'm sure we'll have plenty to show. Great.
Yeah, and just before I click play, in 2 weeks, we have fantastic guests. Carrie Ann is an astro deep space photographer and meteorologist, and she's going to show us how to use our 35mm digital equipment with just telephoto lenses to do some kind of pseudo deep space kind of photography, and how to process it to get the best result. She is just a joy to watch and to listen to. She's so excited about it. So hopefully in 2 weeks you'll join us for that too. And now we'll play us out. Thanks.
Thanks.
I don't know if there was video playing then. I think not, yes, actually.
There was.
Was there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, great.
Okay, well, hopefully everyone else saw it.
If not, they'll have to come back to see you next time that you're here on the Photoshop Show.
Yeah. And so thanks a lot, everyone, and have a great night.
Thanks.